It's a pleasure to be back in this room again. It's been a while for me, and this is an exciting topic. I'm going to talk about Human Longevity, the company. And it was formed just a little over 2 years ago to take a new genomic approach to understanding biology. As Victor said, 20 years ago in June, we sequenced the first genome in history of a living organism. 5 years later, the first version of the human genome. But in the last 15 years, not a whole lot has happened other than technology changes, and there's been quite a few on that front. The genome described in this issue of Science cost $100 million and took 9 months to do by a relatively large team. Recently, we passed the threshold of around $1,500 for a human genome, and that's a big enough change to start to make a difference. We had the earliest remnants of understanding of the genome in that paper. It's not a whole lot better 15 years later because small numbers don't work. We all differ about 3% from each other, and we have to have large numbers of genomes with phenotype and clinical information to understand that 3% variance. So we saw the threshold passing with the sequencing technology, the cost, and the accuracy with the Illumina X10. Computing has changed a lot. In 1999, we built the third largest civilian computer. It cost $50 million, and it was only 1.5 teraflops. And you can buy a card for your PC today for a teraflop for about $100. So the change in computing is equally important. And with distributed computing and cloud computing, it's making a huge difference. We've been working with Amazon Cloud, and people talk about big computes, but most of what cloud computing is used for is things like video streaming. And when we needed thousands of additional processors just to reprocess 10,000 human genomes, they weren't available. So we're working with Amazon from the CEO down to change the nature of large computes. And the third leg of the stool is machine learning, and it's playing a very key role. I recruited Franz Ock out of Google. You all know his work. He developed Google Translate, and with a very small team, translated now well over 100 languages into each other. And when you send something off for Google Translate, it usually takes far less than a second to get back the answer. It's from using the machine learning and distributed computes that make this possible. I convinced him we had the best translation problem for him to tackle, so he came on board. We built the largest human sequencing facility to date. We've already done over 20,000 complete human genomes, but all are accompanied by phenotype and clinical information. And we're trying to get this number well over 1 million over the next few years. But the phenotype data is the biggest challenge, and genome sequences without phenotype and clinical data is virtually worthless to us. So we're using a combination of this large database, lots of different types of computes, but primarily machine learning. And I'll just show you a few of the kinds of things that can be done. As Tom Kasky said earlier, genetics has changed from having large families with disease that you try and sort out mapping for. And here's a case he was referring to of the N of one approach. A single child out of Children's Hospital with a rare disease. Nothing was known about it genetically. You can see from the MRI image the brain is scrambled, and this child's body was covered with multiple tumors. Nothing was known genetically about it. There's only about 30 cases in the world. We sequenced his genome and we sequenced his parents' genome, so we had a trio to get actual tracing things back to each parent. And we find five major genes associated with neuronal development that were disrupted. But the most surprising one was a mutation in the NF1 gene associated originally with elephant man's disease, which would explain his tumors. When we looked at his parents' genome, neither of them had this mutation in the NF1 gene. It was a spontaneous mutation. And it turns out we all have at least a few thousand spontaneous mutations, And you can't trace things back just to each parent, and we need to look specifically at each genome. With cancer, we have a totally different comprehensive program where we sequence the entire genome of the individual, the genome of the tumor to a 90x coverage. We sequence the immune system using the isolated T cell receptor system. We sequence RNA in the tumor. And this is a case of HPV-16 caused head and neck cancer. And with it, it was very stunning. We found a number of mutated oncogenes in this individual. We found genes associated with his immune system that would suppress his immune system. And with the microbiome, we found HPV-16 present. If we find that in any of you, hopefully you can get started on an HPV vaccine, because that's a case where cancer will happen, not just if it might. In his tumor, we found 25,000 mutations, 315 in this protein coding regions. We found why the drug he was on was not working, that target was mutated. Working with the oncologist, we came up with a list of three new drugs that he could be treated with, and he was not a candidate for immune treatment because of there was no immune response against this tumor. Having all these neoantigens gives us opportunities to make specific vaccines for each patient and each tumor, and coupled with immune therapy, I think this is going to be at least part of the solution for cancer. We're using machine learning to try and interpret the human genome. That's why we want all this phenotype data, and we're trying, as you'll see in a second, to predict your face and your voice from your genetic code, your age, disease risk, et cetera. So let me give you a couple of examples. One of the biggest surprises to me, if you'd asked me 15 years ago, I'd say you need to get your genome sequenced once unless you have cancer. But now we can see just from straight sequencing how the genome is changing over time. We tend to shed our X and Y chromosomes, and this is just looking at the loss of X and Y with age. You can see it's not a clear-cut orientation, but pretty much so. We've been hearing lots about telomeres today, and straight from the same sequence, we can very accurately measure your telomere length. And in each case, as was discussed in the last panel, your sequence becomes your control group. Comparing to populations is meaningless. We find lots of changes in the mitochondria. We see sections deleted, we see copy number changes, and it's another thing that correlates roughly with age. Between these and about five other parameters in the genome, including detecting new somatic mutations, we can get a pretty accurate estimation of your age each time we sequence the genome. But we're going the other way. We're using machine learning to try and predict exactly what you look like or would look like. This was one of the earliest attempts using my genome that was on the internet. But it's improved a little bit, so here's an early picture, because what we're finding is your genome predicts a picture of you a little bit post-puberty, which I guess makes sense. So I'm past puberty in 1985, but it's one of the only profile pictures we got, but not mentally yet. So here's the actual computer prediction with nothing but the genetic code. And the team just showed how nicely that lines up. So it's just doing face, but we're adding, through MRI imaging, the exact shape of the jaw and the skull. It's not very simple because we don't have simple lineages. And here's a 40-year-old woman that you can just see from the different predicted compositions from her genetic background, that you can't do this just based on ethnicity and race. But here's predictions at this stage of the game, predicting her face, which predicting skin color, eye color are now extremely accurate, and getting the face is getting better all the time. The original picture comes from a 3D camera that does extensive pixelation, and you can see the predicted images are much more like the smooth images in these cases. It's not perfect yet, but as the training sets get larger, we're extremely confident this will change dramatically. Some of the biggest surprises to me are in the voice. We can predict your age, your sex, and your height just from a voice recording. And we can find clear-cut correlations between your voice and shapes of the face. So all of this is going to come out in a number of unique predictive algorithms, but if we can predict these things accurately, maybe we can start to predict your future and your disease risk in different areas. So if you're a male and you're between 50 and 75, you have a 30% chance of dying during that period. Roughly a third of that risk is from cancer and a third from heart disease. If you're a woman, you only have a 20% chance of dying, cancer being a slightly larger contributor than cardiovascular disease, but you can see the other diseases listed. Our view of aging is if we can predict risk for disease where something could be done about it early, it will change human longevity. So we're taking this highly integrative approach, measuring parameters from the metabolome, the microbiome, to a number of imaging and other approaches. So here's a partial list of what we do with whole body imaging, pulmonary tests, brain imaging, and cardiovascular. And just to show you some of these, this is one of two GE3T MRIs that we have at HLI. Obviously, this is becoming really good for detecting brain changes associated with Alzheimer's disease. And the algorithms developed by Anders Dale at UCSD are more accurate than any pathologist and can detect changes in your brain in as little as 3 months. In fact, we think we can predict changes between the genome and the imaging 20 years before you would get symptoms. Now, early on with imaging, people came up with lots of incidental omas. Now, with this new diffusion-weighted imaging, just using the properties of water, we get some amazing images. So here's just looking at the carotid arteries in an individual, and here's looking just at the brain blood vessels. There's no dye here. This is totally non-invasive and takes a very short period of time, so it can be done every month if there's a need to. With these differentials now, the incidentalomas can be differentiated from outright cancer, and these tests are getting to be extremely accurate. We can detect water and fat and muscle, and there's a team, AMRA, that can quantify these very accurately. So if you want to measure muscle wasting or visceral or peripheral fat, the fat associated with your liver, they can be measured very quantitatively and precisely. This is from the latest CT scanning. This is a picture of my heart. You can get an accurate measurement of your coronary vessels. The neurologist said I had a brain of a 44-year-old and a heart of a 30-year-old. My wife said she thought I had a brain of a 17-year-old and was disturbed that it was so much older. With 4D echo, we can get these incredible color videos of your heart, and you'll see in a second, we can just look right down the valve, actually see the quality of the valve. Again, non-invasive imaging, all this takes less than a day to do. We're trying to integrate it with health records, with constant wearable devices to integrate this across your life, your data, to get accurate interpretation of the genome. And we have data coming from the pharma industry, from the insurance industry, and from all our own measurements. So it's an exciting time, and we're delighted to be trying to push these new limits with what can happen with genomics integrated with the rest of our lives. Thank you very much.